Hello and welcome to yet another episode of Asian Tigers. Coming out of Hong Kong this time, you've heard the experts from Singapore. Right now it's drilling down to another geography out here, where a young Indian manager, young, around my age I guess, Ayaz Motiwala has had a career in India, but now he's running a fund out of Hong Kong called the Amala Emerging Asia Fund. He's essentially a mid-cap stock picker, and his fund focuses on small caps and mid-caps. Ayaz, good to see you after many years.
Thank you, Uday.
How easy or difficult is it to make a mid-cap portfolio right now out of India, given where valuations have run up and where you find stock prices today?
Right. It's a very interesting question. I don't know how many dollars is it worth, but I would start off by saying we are slightly under 2 years old.
Yeah.
And even when we raised money in July 2015, the mid-caps had a run for, 2 to 4 years.
Right.
And we could have raised our hand and said, the valuations don't stack up in a conventional way, and we're just going to be sitting on a lot of cash and wait for the standard conventional high-quality stocks, which we try to do, such as a Levers or Marico, Nestle or Sun Pharma, Infosys, etc., for a long time. And those wouldn't have fitted any which ways as we roll forward 2 years now. So we took it up as a challenge and basically said, let's look at it, on three distinct sort of way buckets in which we try and buy stocks. One would be, the conventional high quality stocks at fairly aggressive valuations. We pay up for it and we hope that our judgment is correct. Here we are trying to play a sort of time in our favor because we have long dated capital. So we are trying to buy 2 years out earnings expectations. So that's one type of approach. The other, at the other end of the spectrum would be stocks which are smaller in size, are yet to be discovered, and have both the need of time and the need of liquidity. So we try and fish in those waters as well. And then in the middle is where it gets very interesting, which is another way to basically say we're trying to buy slightly broken companies, colloquially referred as buying turnarounds, but with the sharp focus on quality. So we're trying to say we've seen this company do well for 3-4 years, and it seems to have near-term problems. And this near term is the nebulous word. So if you get it right, then actually you're buying a high quality company which got into a spot of bother because of raw material pressure, competition, etc., or a contract getting cancelled, which are addressable issues, and we can actually get into the ride on a compounding story at such names.
Which of these three categories that you just outlined tests your mettle as a fund manager more? Which of these three would you classify as the riskiest?
I think the middle one clearly, because it's often said, and I've probably heard you saying so often, is turnarounds don't turn around. Mm. And so this judgment of problem, and also the judgment on timing when this problem would go away, is obviously a very, very tough act.
Have you made mistakes with the middle category in the last couple of years?
Oh, absolutely. I'd like to own up on one name, which we thought is actually borderline between the second and the third category, which is we thought it's under-discovered and it's only a 2-year track record, but we think we know and we understand the business. Mm. And this is a company called Camlin Life Sciences, or Fine Sciences, sorry.
Camlin Fine Chemicals.
Yeah, okay. Camlin Fine Chemicals. And so we own another stock also in Specialty Chem, and we thought it's on that kind of track.
Okay.
They basically are a food antioxidants company.
Yeah.
And they weren't even sort of so badly broken or challenged. They had to execute on what they had in front of them. And our sense is that the execution has suffered. The numbers have actually not come through, giving them a time of nearly the entire fund period that we owned it from, sort of, July, August of 2015. It's getting to, 2 years.
What typically was their mistake? I mean, was the original story call wrong, or have they slipped up along the way?
Okay, so multiple things have happened.
Okay.
I would say, let's say to start with, in an oversimplified way, let's say we are expecting, say, you know, revenue growth to come through, margins to be intact, and thus profit to come through. Capital productivity being similar as in the past, so no massive change in working capital or fixed asset is the kind of premise on long-term compounders. So I would say in the case of Camlin, all of these three or four levers have actually not delivered or have gone wrong. So I think the sales have not come through because a couple of customers have actually cancelled contracts or have renegotiated prices lower because of operating costs hurting them. Margins have actually taken a big hit, in fact. Their project is behind the curve, so the capital has been put to work, but it's not that productive. Yeah. So it's at multiple levels that this attempt has been challenged.
Can it be resurrected, or you're throwing in the towel with that name?
No, we are actually staying the course. Okay. There is hope there. The more recent couple of quarters, they seem to be sort of stabilizing on what they've done. They've raised a small amount of capital as well. So they seem to be wanting to bolster the balance sheet. And then the acquisitions which they have done, they are hoping that they actually start contributing more in towards the end of financial year 18 and more significantly in 19.
You alluded to another name. I think it's Vinathi Organics that you own.
Right.
That's made you happier with your investment?
Yeah, and as you look back, I think the relative nervousness was more in that name in relation to Camlin, to be honest, on the buying decision. And so in terms of even sizing the position, that was probably sized at, you know, like a 75% weightage equivalent to what Camlin was sized at.
Okay.
You know, let's call it, you know, 3% and 2%. So,
but what about starting valuations in both of these names? Were they similar, or did you overpay for one or underpay for another?
No, so I think Vinathi has if you look at their 10-year sort of numbers, they're just outstanding numbers. And, you know, they're a kind of consumer company-like numbers, despite the fact that they actually really sell, you know, bulk or tonnages kind of chemicals rather than selling, you know, consumer packaged goods. Their numbers are that good. And so the market obviously, you know, got the smell right, and the stock moved up from the 250-300 handle to 500-600, and then the oil prices came off and people linked it to oil. So we sort of got in at 400-450 levels, after which it actually declined another 15-20%. And this is absolutely in line with the way oil prices went. So oil prices went from 100-120 to sort of 60 or even lower, more like 45, right? And so people linked it, saying this is going to go to $30, and so the stock is going to collapse. And over this 2-year period, it's kind of surprised. It's nearly up 60-80% for us in dollar terms. Currency has gone nowhere. It's like not depreciated. So that, as you asked, on a 2-year basis, that has been a more than bargain for positive surprise.
And the best is yet to come, you think, there?
I think so. Just the way they approach the business, I think it is not a very lucky streak that they've hit on. When you see 10-year, 12-year financials of a company going from such a small size to where they are, they've actually got a process in what they do with. So they started with this one particular product, and then they have built around it. There are these institutions on which they take inputs from. They actually encourage primary research, then take those, build on their own chemistry skills, and then basically approach a particular market. So they have a certain approach, and it seems that if we are believers of specialty chem over a, you know, 3 to 5 year perspective, I think there's still more to come.
Okay, let me ask you about the first category that you mentioned, which is strong growth, but very high valuations, and you can see a lot of that in the mid-cap space today, between 30 and 50 kind of P multiples, which for mid-cap is astronomical, but they keep delivering 30-40% growth every year.
Right.
In that category, what are your hits and misses over the last couple of years?
Right. So, the name which we own very proudly for a long period of time is Semarico.
And hardly a mid cap. I mean, it was the last cap when you bought it.
Yeah, in the context of sort of year, you could say it is still at, you know, $6-7 billion market cap, a mid-sized company. But to highlight the number, we bought the stock two times over, November 15, and then demonetization again November 16. Essentially, more than 2 years forward, which with the point that I said that we have time on our side and we're looking at things a little ahead. So when you equated that to lots of new names, the names that you said are trading at 30, 50 times, we thought a old, slightly slower growing but more confident on delivery kind of company is being equated at the same valuations.
Yeah.
So we chose to be in that camp on that name. And I think the stock is up nearly 45-50%. So a 200 rupees stock is kind of 300 from November 15 to now. And we bought back in November 16 as well at 240, 250 when the stock came off in demonetization. So the point here I'm trying to highlight is that, you know, it's kind of a larger issue that this whole mid-cap thing that we talk about and the excitement around it. And I'd like to make a point here, which is, for us, we're trying to buy, superior businesses which are growing fast, superior in quality, growing faster, and not paying up the full price. More likely than not, you actually land up in the smaller and mid-cap basket. And I guess it's just the size and the rapid growth versus it being profitable growth in terms of return on capital ratios, capital productivity, may be missing. And so in a bull charge, we'll get carried away. And you know, we'll be part of that brigade. So we'll have to be careful on what we do, on how much we stretch ourselves on going down the cap curve, so to speak. And where do we give the latitude on this turnaround category, or where do we give the under research category buckets B and C that much more latitude to get in? I think it is it's an interesting point that the market is on.